Our speaker today is Dr. Charles Swindoll. Dr. Swindoll served Dallas Seminary well as its fourth president. He's known by millions around the world for his practical application of the Bible to everyday living. He now serves Dallas Seminary as chancellor and is currently the senior pastor of Stonebriar Community Church in Frisco, Texas. Dr. Swindoll is the author of more than 50,000 books. Can you believe this? I can't believe what it actually said. 90 books? My goodness. And is the featured Bible teacher on the popular radio program Insight for Living, which is aired nearly 2,000 times daily worldwide. Chuck and Cynthia, his partner in life and ministry, reside here in the Metroplex and love to spend time with their 4 grown children, 10 grandchildren, and 6 great-grandchildren. Yeah. Amen. Dr. Swindoll happens to be my pastor, and I happen to know that he is soon going to California to see his grandson, Noah, graduate from Marine boot camp, where Dr. Swindoll graduated 60 years ago, same boot camp. Help me in welcoming Dr. Swindoll to our
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, Chaplain. And welcome to all of you incoming students. I say, based on faith, that God may have his way in your life, and if he leads you here, we want you here. If he doesn't, we don't want you here. So you follow his lead, and we will all be thrilled. And I certainly am sincere when I say a warm, warm welcome to each of you. You haven't seen our faculty. Let's have our faculty stand up. They never are recognized, and I want to recognize them today. That's about 1/10 of them over here that are here today. But thank you for all you do as well. I read a line this morning as I was leaving my home that has sort of stuck with me. Only 6 words. Tom Brady is a tough nut. Peter Kling writes that toward the end of the most recent Sports Illustrated issue that's on the table near the chair where I sit in our family room, and I'm looking forward to reading the complete article. I read enough to know why Peter King would write that. He describes Tom Brady as they were discussing Tom's career over the last 15, 18, 20 years. And maybe you don't know this, I didn't know it, but Brady wants to play quarterback until he's 45 years old. That'll make him the oldest quarterback in the history of the NFL, if he lives to see 45 years of age at that position. He has been hit, he has been injured, he has been criticized, he has been accused, he has been penalized 4 games this first of this last season. He has won more of the trophies than anyone else when it comes to the Super Bowl. He is an outstanding athlete, and he is tough. And in the words of Peter King, he is one tough nut. He puts it all in those few words. And I suppose an athlete would feel good having that written about him. So the thought struck me as I was driving away to come join you here. What one line would you want said of you when you reach the pinnacle of your career? What 6 words would you hope some biographer would write of you, some colleague, who is engaged in the work you're doing, whatever that may be. And let's make you his age. Tom Brady is now 39. He'll be 40 before the season begins toward the end of August, early September, this coming fall. 40 years old, still going strong. I'm sure you hope when you're 40, you'll be going strong. When I was 40, I remember well being engaged in ministry on the West Coast, involved in a work that was growing and in many ways stretching. And now I am twice that age, and looking back over the years, I think of how good God has been, how faithful, how beautifully he has provided for my family and me in ways that the next 10 years I could not completely describe. But what one line would be appropriate? I would draw the line from Jesus' description of himself. The only place in all the Bible where he describes his makeup. He says it on the end of an invitation. Come to me, all who are weary and overburdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble in heart. That's the line. If you want to be like Jesus, you want to be meek and humble in heart. In even less words, you want to be a servant. There is no greater calling in life, in all of the careers of life, than being a servant of others. If there were a greater calling, Jesus would have filled it. But when he came, having left heaven, to be on this earth for less time than most of us are old, never married, passed up many, many, many occasions to make a name for himself, and gave himself for 3 years and a few more months to giving and to serving, so that we might know life as we would otherwise never know it. And in light of today, I think I need to also warn you about any other one line, because there are many temptations to go elsewhere and to do other things that will be far more, shall we say, glamorous, attractive, popular, lucrative. But this one line stays with me, and that is that we cultivate the role of servants. I want you to think about that. And I want you who are thinking about seminary training to think seriously about a lifetime of that. Those who have ministered most to me have been those who were marked by humility, which is a synonym for servanthood. Before we look at John 13, I want to first look at Romans chapter 12. If you have your Bible with you, I want you to turn to this very practical chapter, surprising to some people who think of Romans only as a doctrinal treatise. This latter part of Romans has as much practical direction in it as any letter in the New Testament, as any book of the Bible. And I want to draw from a few verses just some sort of punctuated statements that sort of bounce off the page of Romans 12. Paul writes in verse 3, "Through the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think so as to have sound judgment." Notice it doesn't say think more lowly. Being a servant, being humble, is not thinking lowly of yourself. It's, as he puts it, thinking with sound judgment, knowing who you are, accepting who you are, and being who you are, without any pretense, without any desire to promote yourself, just operating as God has allotted to you the giftedness he has given you. And then he gets into details. I know it's a little below your level of sophistication as scholars at this school, but I want to read the rest of the section that I have in mind from Romans 12 from Eugene Peterson's The Message, because he puts it on the shelf that every one of us can reach. Listen to the way he writes it. "So let's go ahead and be what we were made to be, without enviously or proudly comparing ourselves with each other." This, by the way, is the way a servant operates. Not to compare ourselves with anyone else, or trying to be something we aren't. "If you preach," Eugene Peterson paraphrases verse, I can't find it here, but "if you preach, just preach God's message, nothing else. If you help, just help. Don't take over." That sounds like a servant. Just help. "If you teach, stick to your teaching. If you give encouraging guidance, be careful that you don't get bossy. If you're put in charge, don't manipulate. If you're called to give aid to people in distress, keep your eyes open and be quick to respond. If you work with the disadvantaged, don't let yourself get irritated with them or depressed by them." And then he gets to the word that I mentioned in my last message to you here in verse 9, which is rendered here by Paul, "Let love be without hypocrisy." Peterson renders it, "Love from the center of who you are. Don't fake it. Run for dear life from evil. Hold on for dear life to good. Be good friends." A little later, he writes, "Get along with each other. Don't be stuck up. Make friends with nobodies. Don't be the great somebody." Now, why do I begin my thoughts on servanthood with that passage? Because there is every temptation on the planet in studying at this school to begin to think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. You gain knowledge you didn't have when you came. Of course you do. It's part of getting a great education. I love the definition of a good education. It's going from an unconscious to conscious awareness of our own ignorance. You realize that is a subculture of information that the school makes you aware of, and you can be enraptured by it. There's hardly a student who loves to study who doesn't get enraptured by the study itself. The course becomes exciting and stimulating, and before long, you easily can get heady and high-minded. Nothing wrong with knowledge. It just puffs up if it isn't mixed with love and compassion. And our word today, servanthood. So that's why I began in Romans 12 to sort of set the stage for what we're going to see in John 13. No better model of these things than Jesus himself. So turn to John 13, please, and let's spend the rest of our time right here. And please understand where we are when we turn to John 13. He has only a few hours to live. I wonder how it would be if we knew when we were going to die and we had a chance for a meal with the very best friends we have. I wonder how we would conduct ourselves. And he knew how he would die. He knew all that lay in front of him. In fact, we read that verse 1, before the feast of the Passover, knowing that his hour had come, that he would depart out of this world to the Father. So he already knew that. He knew he would soon die. He knew he loved these men. He knew it would soon all rest with them. And he had been training them for these 3+ years. He loved them to the end. The last part of verse 1 reminds us. And then John mentions the presence of Judas. He has Judas sitting among them, the devil, having already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot to betray him. Wonder how that felt. You know what else Jesus knew? He knew that their hearts were proud. I say that because when you look at cross references and parallel sections in Mark as well as in Matthew, you see that right here at this table, they're arguing over who is going to be the greatest. That always sort of takes my breath away. After being with him for these 3 years, they're still arguing over which one of them is going to be number one. They still aren't getting it. You know what else he knew? He knew their feet were dirty, which explains why he did what he did. Verse 4. He got up from supper and laid aside his garment. Before I go any further, we have the idea of the Last Supper based on the painting of every one of these disciples sitting behind a long table on New England ladderback chairs facing the artist. And that's not the way it was at all. They reclined at the table. There were no chairs. They ate while leaning on an elbow, and they ate with their hands. So that means that their feet were rather prominent to the partner near them. And Jesus could see easily and quickly that they had come and no one had washed anybody's feet. There they were with proud hearts and dirty feet, having their last meal with Jesus. And so he got up and he took a towel and he girded himself, poured water into the basin and began to wash the disciples' feet. Chances are good you've never once had your feet washed by anyone else. Chances are good you've never been in a foot washing service of any church, unfortunately. Chances are good all of this is theory, because it's a little bit below our dignity, unfortunately. to do that sort of thing. No one writes about it better than Philip Yancey. In his great book, The Jesus I Never Knew. As I read John's account, writes Yancey, I keep coming back to a peculiar incident that interrupts the progress of the meal. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. John begins with a flourish and then adds this incongruous completion. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. Now picture it in your mind. Make yourself one of the disciples. You haven't washed anybody's feet. And of all things, the master gets up, interrupts his meal, takes on the garb of a slave, bends over and begins to wash the grime of Jerusalem from the disciples' feet. Stay with it. Listen closely. What a strange way for the guest of honor to act during a final meal with his friends. What incomprehensible behavior from a ruler who would momentarily announce, "I confer on you a kingdom." In those days, foot washing was considered so degrading that a master could not require it of a Jewish slave. Peter blanched at the provocation. The scene of the foot washing stands out to author Scott Peck as one of the most significant events of Jewish life, of Jesus' life. Quote, until that moment, the whole point of things had been for someone to get on top. And once he had gotten on top, to stay on top, or else to attempt to get further up. But here, this man, already on top, who was rabbi, teacher, master, suddenly got down to the bottom and began to wash the feet of his followers. In that one act, Jesus symbolically overturned the whole social order. Hardly comprehending what was happening, even his own disciples were horrified by his behavior. We don't spend enough time thinking about scenes. We're too busy parsing verbs and declining the nouns and analyzing the context to put ourselves in the place of disciples with dirty feet. And I would say most of us this day have dirty feet. Our feet stink. That's why we put shoes on, or it's part of the reason. The problem is in taking them off. When my youngest son would take off his sneakers during his high school years, the dog would howl. That's how bad his feet stank. Our feet stink. Jesus asked his followers to do three things to remember him. He asked us to baptize others. He asked us to remember the meal he shared the very evening with the disciples. Finally, he asked us to wash one another's feet. The church has always honored two of those commands, although with much dispute about what they mean and how best to fulfill them. But today we tend to associate the third, foot washing, with small denominations tucked away in the hills of Appalachia. Only a few small denominations carry on the practice of foot washing. For the rest, the whole notion seems primitive, rural, unsophisticated. I would hope before you graduate from seminary that you take time for a small group of you together to wash one another's feet. Just as an expression of love for one another. Now, I want to point out some things about this act of servanthood that you could easily pass over not one of them seems at the moment all that profound, but I think you will realize the significance of each when I name it. First, I want to say humility is unannounced. Jesus got up from supper, laid aside garments, girded himself with a towel, poured water, began to wash feet. Not a word. No, I am now going to illustrate what it means to be the servant that you're not. None of that. By the way, the first time you call attention to humility, it immediately turns to pride. So if you plan to be a servant, don't spend too much time working on the speech. Just serve. Just wash. I love it that he didn't make an announcement. Everything seemed to move along pretty well until he got to Peter. You know the story, don't you? Verse 6, he came to Simon Peter and said, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" If I were reclining here, I would do that, but I couldn't get back up if I reclined. So I'm going to illustrate it, you know, by tucking my feet back. I think he pulled his feet under him. Not mine. You're not going to wash my feet. And Jesus answered and said, "What I do, you do not realize now, but you'll understand hereafter. Never, never will you wash my feet." The audacity. You know why Peter said that? Because he was proud. You see, it takes humility to receive, which is my second observation. Humility is unannounced. Second, humility is being willing to receive without embarrassment. Peter needed to learn how to receive. The smarter you get, the harder it will be for you to receive from anybody else. The more capable you are, the more difficult it will be for you to let someone else serve you. James Sullivan, in a recent book, The Frog Who Never Became a Prince, faced a severe crisis. His wife, Carolyn, broke emotionally. She had emotional breakdown and was admitted to a psychiatric ward of a local hospital for an extended period of time. He was humiliated, broken, bruised, felt guilty, even resentful. In himself and toward God, he went home that lonely night after admitting her and tried to explain to Kathy and Scott, their two small children. And then he began to cry, first time ever for James Sullivan to cry before his children. Some of you never have. Tragically. Your children need to see you cry. Because in your tears, they'll learn more about you than they'll ever learn from your mouth. So he cries for the first time. Amazingly, people from the family of God at the church began to come to Sullivan's side. One dropped by and just embraced him. Others brought meals night after night after night after night after night. Others picked up the tab when they would go to a little cafe for a meal. Others cleaned the house. Many wrote emails and letters for him. Some stayed near in the midst of that crisis hour over the weeks until James Sullivan learned how to receive. My wife went through a deep depression before we left seminary. She was on a bad pharmaceutical prescription that they thought would help her, drove her deeper. We had lost a baby, almost lost a second. We had one, and we lost a baby, and our little girl, Carissa, we thought because of a car accident that totaled our car, we thought we'd lose her, and Cynthia just plunged, had a complete breakdown. The depression was horrible. Not a soul at the seminary understood. I was in my senior year. I'll never forget admitting her to Timberlawn, all alone. And coming back to our little campus apartment with my little boy. And ultimately, we had moved to a house. I forget. We were now in our home and living in Dallas. And I remember thinking, how am I going to make it? What am I going to say to people? Back in those days, it was considered something less than spiritual for anybody to have a breakdown. When you had emotional problems, you were called nervous. That's a nice word, isn't it? I heard your wife's nervous. No, she's not nervous. She's been given the wrong drugs, and they decide to put her in a psychiatric hospital. So Cynthia has that in her background, very humiliating, as you can imagine. Here I am ministering as Dr. Pentecost's assistant. He knew, his wife knew, very few people knew, because in those days, when you let that be known, you were marked. There was something wrong with you. So I understand James Sullivan. I learned more during that 4.5 month period than I learned during 4 years at Dallas Seminary. Certainly learned more about people. I remember coming to the school one day. I just could hardly go on. I had a half a semester left. Or I had the last semester left to finish. And I was trying to find a prof to talk to. They were all too busy. I remember knocking on one door. And I saw the light on under the door, and he peeked out. Yes, what do you want? Was his kind opening. And I said, I don't want anything from you. Closed the door. He was a great teacher in that particular subject. Thankfully, he's no longer with the school. But he had no idea what compassion was about. But let me tell you who knew. Howard G. Hendricks knew. And he took time for me. And he put his arm around me. And he wept with me. And he visited Cynthia. And he wept with her. And I learned during that time how to receive. It was hard. So Peter said, you're not going to wash my feet. Please observe the response in case you think servanthood is a sign of weakness. Jesus said to him, if I do not wash you, you have no part with me. So the third thing I want to point out is that servanthood is not a sign of weakness. It's a sign of great strength. He told Peter to his face, you're either in or you're out. And if you're in, I'm washing your feet, buddy. He didn't say buddy, but you know, you got the idea. Sort of in your face, Peter. Settle down, buddy. Give me your feet. They're dirty like everybody else's. So Peter, you know, then jumped in, said something stupid, you know, wash my head, my hands, everything, you know, give me a bath. Jesus says, once bathed, always bathed. You don't need to be bathed. I just need to do your feet. So give me your feet. Verse 12, it's all over. By the way, let me mention one more, just occurs to me. Humility doesn't play favorites. He also washed Judas' feet. You ever thought about that? When Judas went out into the night, verse 30, to carry out his awful deed, and then to spend eternity in hell where he belonged, he went out with clean feet. Not only was he offered the sop, he went out with clean feet. Being a servant means you don't play favorites. You're not selective. You're not exclusive. You serve whoever needs to be served. And when it was all over, I got to wrap this up. When it was all over, he said, do you know what I've done to you? Now watch closely. Verse 13. You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for I am. I'm no less teacher, I'm no less Lord, because I've washed feet. Doesn't demote anything in who I am. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you would think it would say, you ought also wash my feet, right? I would think that. And you know what? We'd all get in line to wash Jesus' feet. But that's not what he said. You ought to also wash one another's feet. What a privilege to wash Jesus' feet. What an honor. I'd love it if the first thing in heaven I have the privilege of washing his feet, though they're never dirty. I'd have the privilege of all privileges to bow before him and wash his feet. But to wash one another's feet? To wash an enemy's feet? I gave you an example, verse 15, that you should do as I did. Verse 17, if you know these things, and you now know them, blessed are you if you do them, but you haven't yet done them, more than likely. When I was in California, I was a good friend with Ruth Harms Calkin. I think she's dead now, a wonderful poetess. She wrote this. You know, Lord, how I serve you with great emotional fervor in the limelight? You know how eagerly I speak for you at a women's club? You know my genuine enthusiasm at a Bible study? But how would I react, I wonder, if you pointed to a basin of water and asked me to wash the calloused feet of a bent and wrinkled old woman day after day, month after month, in a room where nobody saw and nobody knew? Let me tell you something. If someday in the future God has really used you and put you in a position where you are the sort of a household name among people, and you are respected and loved and quoted and revered, and you have the opportunity to serve your mate, your spouse, during a lengthy illness, or to help some dear old saint who can't help herself, you will show the greatest evidence of servanthood in that act. And I will say of you, should I hear about it, just as Peter King said of Tom Brady, he's one tough nut. I will say of you, you are one humble soul, which may be the greatest compliment you could ever hear. Because that is Christ-likeness at its best. This kind of thing will never make the headlines, but the best things in ministry don't make headlines. Just remember, he must increase, I must decrease. Were the whole realm of nature mine that were present far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. When I surveyed the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and poor contempt on what? All my pride.